Hello there, everybody. Welcome back to more Slay the Spire Draft Champions with Rhapsody. Raps, how are you today?
Hey, pretty damn good, yourself?
Oh, I'm here. I'm alive. Mm-hmm. I'm awake.
Are we not lying? Okay, then I'm fine. Okay.
Yeah, it's great today. We're doing a Watcher run. It's just the Watcher.
Hell yeah.
15 cards. Chat doesn't get a deck. Hell, you chat won last time without a deck. Mm-hmm. So who knows, right? Who knows?
May happen again this time.
All right. Heads or tails?
Why don't you give me a little bit of the tails action there?
Okay. A little tails action. 5, 4, 3, 2, and one more click.
Well, thank you.
A little anticlimactic for sure.
It's taking a moment to inspect this world to figure out which material to go for.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
Yeah, the only annoying thing is, like, there's no anger triggers on the entire board.
Yeah.
The wrath triggers. Sorry.
I got what you were saying.
All right, I'll go next too.
I don't think I like that.
Yeah, sorry about it, bud.
Yeah.
This, like, with just one repeatable Wrath trigger, this deck would be so good.
Yeah. Oh, I'm gonna take what I consider to be just, like, one of the best cards in the game.
It's a very, very good.
Yeah.
So, you take first, and then I take next two, and then it's back to Ordinary?
Correct, yeah.
I'm taking Empty Mind and Fear No Evil.
Pretty good.
It should be
good. Okay. Let's see here. Let's go with a... Let's go with a... Sanctity.
Taking Fear No Evil again?
Okay. And then I'm going to take a Prostrate.
Mm-hmm. Empty Body.
I'm going to take a... I don't need to yet. I'm going to take a... Let's go with a Wheel Kick.
Fasting.
I will also take a Wallop.
Ah! That was my next. all right. See, there's stuff on this board that I don't think I need to compete against you for.
That is true.
I'll take Third Eye.
Okay. I will take a Consecrate.
Take a Tranquility.
I mean, dude, you've forced my hand. I'm gonna take Diva Form.
Yep. That was a huge part of it, was me guaranteeing my energy generation whilst denying it from you.
Yeah.
It's,
I thought, like, I'm not gonna keep it, but, like, I might as well use it early.
Yeah, that's totally fair.
Let's do a... Oh, at this point, I need the Prey in the deck. I'll take the other Protect.
Makes sense. I'll take the other Sanctity then.
Okay. You want the other Prey?
No, I'm fine. How about you go for that?
I'm okay. I'll take Signature Move. Mm. Got a lot of expensive cards.
Mm-hmm. Let's go... No, not Battleham, actually. Study? Study.
Okay. I'll take Halt.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fair enough. Let's go Cut Through Fates.
Take Follow-Up.
Do I bother with an Omniscience in this deck?
You will bother with it for sure.
Taking Carve Reality.
Okay. I'll take Pressure Points.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really care about it, but I'll take.
See, I wonder, like, maybe I take Prey and look in the shop for a little bit more mantra or something like that. Sure, I'll take Prey.
All right, I will take... I'll take Battle Him.
Strike.
It's the worst.
what card am I taking? Sorry, what?
It's the worst. All right. Do we do this every week, and I ask you this every week. Do we flip again for relics?
Yeah, we usually do. Okay. Let's just do it.
All right. Heads or tails?
Let's go with the heads on this one.
Okay. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 1, 1 more.
Still heads.
Look at you.
I'm gonna take first. I'm just gonna take the sling.
Okay, I genuinely don't care about any of these, so I'm going
all gold.
Big brain money, and let's roll it.
I like it. I like it. I am. Eternal Feather is never really gonna be that much health, right?
Absolutely not.
I'm gonna put that many cards in the deck. There are a good amount of X-Cost cards for this character that are pretty interesting, but a lot of them are in a rare set, and if we have none in the base deck, that's what to take. This is for poison?
Yeah, completely useless.
I guess I'll go with the anti-attrition.
Yeah. All right.
Not a great relic selection this time.
No. I mean, to be fair, I'm pretty happy with my relics, but it's basically I'm happy with my relics to buy other relics. So, am I really happy with my relics?
So, these are rerolls as well as the money, so you can remove the data form and
Yeah. But, hey, good decks. Happy decks. We're going to take our happy decks, slap them together, and we're going to go hop into the run.
Mm-hmm. We will see you there.
Okay, we're back. We have all of our cards and our relics into our decks and our relic slots. Are you ready, Raps?
And... I'm totally ready, and this time you didn't get to hear behind the scenes. Sorry about that.
I'm just glad that I didn't wake up to, like, Alexa's canceled because I said chat sucks in the interim period.
As soon as I woke up and I saw the messages that it has left that part in, despite the edits that I did put through, which are now finally put through, thankfully. Yeah, as soon as that happened, I immediately had to watch the whole section to be like, oh no, there's nothing I said that was, like, awful, right?
Yeah, it's, like, always... I mean, it's not... It can't really be a fear of mine if I have no reason to be afraid, but it's still a fear, like...
Yeah, exactly. It's the same kind of, like, I saw a policeman. I hope I haven't committed any crimes. I don't think I did. Uh-oh.
Yeah. I'm gonna refuse to continue that conversation any further.
Yeah, I didn't really think about the context before I started it. Because that is, like, my go-to way of explaining that. Like, that kind of paralyzing moment of, I didn't do anything wrong, but, oh no.
Yo, this friggin' gremlin stab you?
Gremlin ain't done jack and or squat to me yet.
I see. Well, don't worry.
I think I'm about to get stabbed by a gremlin.
That's fair, yeah.
Hey, why'd you have to stab me? Why didn't you warn me about this?
Unfortunate, isn't it?
Really, really is.
It would have been a great time for them to just, like, give me a card removal so I didn't have to do some of these card removals myself. Because I don't care about a lot of cards in my deck.
Yeah, you do seem to have a lot of trash in
there. I got a lot of trash in my deck. And my deck will be pretty good if I can get the trash out of my deck.
A lot of the question marks on floor one are card removal opportunities, so it's possible.
That is also true. None of the ones I've gone to, but true.
Yeah, I'm certain they're out there. At least.
somewhere in the wild blue yonder. But nowhere that my eyes can see. Oh, Raps, how was your past, when was the last, it's 7 days?
Yeah. I mean, hang on, you did turn up for a small amount of the Wholesome Verse Live, did you not?
I did.
Yeah, so 6 days.
Yeah, true. Yeah,
It's been good, working with people and recording a Wholesome Verse Live has still been kind of, you know, the highlight.
Dude, I'm with you. I'm with you. Little Project Winty and little fibbage with fibbers.
I was so happy that that went as well as I'd expected.
Yeah.
Because Fibbage Enough About You was the mode that I'd pitched specifically to play for it, because I think it's really nice to be that kind of like, hey, getting to know you, but we work together, but this is kind of like esoteric knowledge that you wouldn't necessarily get over the course of conversation.
Yeah. Oh crap, dude. Apparently freaking marking the Lagavulin. He takes the damage immediately and then wakes up.
Yeah.
That sucks.
Of course he does. Well, I mean, yeah. The pressure points says in that order, right?
Yeah. You'd think I would have seen that, huh?
Yeah.
And now I can't play D.Va form. Yikes.
It's easy to miss.
Oh, well. Oh, well, right. Oh, well. That's okay. Anywho.
How was your last week?
Yeah. It was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good week. It was a week full of things and stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
The best kinds of weeks are the weeks filled with things and stuff.
Look, I'd prefer if it was just things, but if stuff has to be involved as well, I guess I can.
Yeah. If we gotta involve the stuff, then you gotta involve the stuff. It's kind of just it's how it goes at this point. But there was things, there was stuff. I'm ready for the weekend, and it's Tuesday. So
maybe the weekend, then it's Tuesday. So you work I'm assuming a standard Monday to Friday.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It's lovely. I would recommend it to everybody. A lot of fun all the time.
Well, you know, I don't get sarcasm, so I guess yeah, that must be the case.
Yeah. Yeah. Good experience. But yeah, I mean, I'm chilling, dude. I've been enjoying a couple of new games here and there.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to see if there was any Rhapsody inklings to play a little thing called Rogue Legacy 2.
Ooh, yeah, there is. I mentioned this in a stream a while ago, but one of the first series that I did on the channel ever was Rogue Legacy 1 with my partner Peek, who at the time I was calling my friend. So, like, long storied history to that game on the channel. Yeah, I do want to do the game with him, and he also wants to do the game with me, but we just haven't really had the opportunity to get it recorded yet.
Yeah.
Have you been diving into the Rogue Legacy?
I've been roguing my legacy. Mm-hmm. It's good, I think.
Ooh, yeah. Okay.
It's like, I think What's it's the, good. It's a... I mean, look, I'm the kind of guy, I hate meta progression in roguelites, mm-hmm. like, a lot, like, nth degree level of a lot, yep. And Rogue Legacy is literally meta progression the roguelite, right? Mm-hmm. So, it kind of, you know, I have my times where I'm like, this blows, and I hate it, but then I'm like, it doesn't actually blow, it's just like... I'm frustrated because I'm bad at the game and the game is better at the game than me. And mm-hmm. yeah.
There's but something I want from this game that I can't.
Yeah. Yeah.
I do worry about that because my general assessment criteria for how I enjoy a roguelike or roguelite has changed significantly since I last played it.
Dude, I agree, to be honest.
I sit very closely on your side of it now. Undermine, I had a lot of problems with their permanent progression system.
I could not agree more with you. I will go Undermine so far as to say I don't actually... Did they fix all of that in the form of the roguelite mode that you need to beat the game to unlock?
No. Othermind, yeah. Othermind is the roguelite mode that you have to beat the game to unlock.
Yeah. Did they fix anything besides just introducing that mode?
Not that I'm aware of. That would be a Rito question right there.
Yeah, that's why I loaded it up the one day, because I found Undermine's gameplay to be okay. Mm-hmm. I hated the meta progression in it a lot. And I was kind of like, you know, oh, I'll load this up. Rito said that it's got the the meta progression is better because of the roguelite mode. So I'll load it up and I'll see what I think about that. And then I loaded it up and I saw the room that he normally goes into to start the roguelite mode. And the door was just a big pile of stone and it wasn't unlocked. And I was like, all right, sounds good. And I alt F4'd the game and I moved on with my day. And I was like, I just have no interest to play this all of a sudden.
You can edit your character file in order to unlock stuff.
I see. Okay. Well, I might have to do that because, like I said, I enjoyed the combat. I just really don't like the meta progression.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I do worry that I'm going to get into Rogue Legacy and I'm going to have that exact same feeling of,
Yeah. I will say the game is, it's super good at keeping you engaged with the wacky content, right? Because they do the, you know, like I was blown away my very first episode of it. I get a character trait where literally it just flipped the entire game upside down. And I was like, this is crazy. And I had never played Rogue Legacy 1. So
okay, so I was about to ask, because that was in Rogue Legacy 1 as far as I recall.
Yeah. So it was just kind of like, you know, it was a surprising thing, and there were just some really, really fun traits that kept on keeping the gameplay fresh. There were things to discover, things to do, and the gameplay itself was enjoyable. So I've been liking it. It's chill.
Is it possible that you would say it's maybe something to engage with at a later date? I know that's in early access at the moment. How would you say the feature completedness of the game is?
So I'm like 4 hours in, which in terms of a roguelite, I think we can both agree that's literally
you
nothing.
Haven't even launched it.
yeah. And I'm almost done with all of the meta progression of the game.
Okay.
So if that, I think that probably gives you a good enough answer to your question.
Yeah. pretty accurate read of that. That's a diplomatic one right there.
Yeah. So like it's there's content for sure.
Mm-hmm.
But there's definitely there is room for more content to be made in the game. So
I need to find someone to ask who did play the Rogue Legacy 1, because I know like Rogue Legacy 1 formed so much of the basis of what we currently understand to be a roguelike and roguelite.
True.
But it'd be really interesting for someone who played Rogue Legacy 1 to now re-engage with the Rogue Legacy series after so many other variations have been made by so many other developers of the genre and format. To have that kind of feeling of like, oh, this is what it originally was. Mm-hmm. I don't even recognize this anymore. This isn't what I would call a roguelike at this point.
Yeah. I don't, dude. I think I was pleasantly surprised by it. Because I'll be perfectly blunt. I went into it expecting to hate it.
Now, why is that?
Because, I hate the meta progression in roguelites.
Right.
Okay. And like, it just, the idea of an entire game that is built around the idea of meta progression, I was like, I'm going to hate this. And then on top of it, I know that, like, because I'm going to hate this, everybody's going to be mad at me for hating this. Because I know that it's such a loved game by so many people. So I expected the worst going into it, and I was pleasantly surprised by how enjoyable parts of the game were. I don't think it's the kind of game that I will end up playing. You know, like for instance, in 16 days, not that I'm counting, Spelunky 2 comes out, and I will, you know, be playing Spelunky 2 for the next year and a half probably. Until I, you know, are not playing it every day kind of thing.
Until I'm not playing it any day.
Look, English is hard, but I...
I agree.
I don't feel that way about Rogue Legacy 2. You know, I know that in the next 2 weeks or so, I probably won't maybe ever touch the game ever again. But it's been a refreshing game to play. And I think that has some value to me.
So like a palate cleanser of a game.
Yeah, I think that's actually a pretty good way to word it. It's been a bit of a palate cleanser.
Okay. So sometimes I do actually like enjoy when a roguelike has very little content. Now, the only reason is because I can't afford to invest another 1,000 hours into another roguelike, right?
Like, yeah.
Sometimes I want a roguelike that I'm like, I've only just learned how to play this game and it's done. Okay. Peace.
I think in general, I want that from like 90% of games made today. Mm-hmm. You know, and I will even go so far as to say, like, I've been struggling with, I've been posting on Twitter and all kinds of stuff. I've been struggling with, like, every game that I load, I just, all of a sudden, 15 minutes into it, I have no desire to play that game.
Yes!
And it's horrible. I'm calling it gamer depression right now.
Uh-huh.
But it sucks. And people are like, what are you talking about? Just play the games that you like. And the thing is, like, you know, sure, I could sit there and play online Dominion for all my content, but people aren't going to watch me play online Dominion for all my content. People are expecting me to play certain games, right? Mm-hmm. So it's difficult from a creator perspective for us to make the decision to just play the games you want. But then even like, you know, I'll be like, oh, I really just need a chill night. I'm going to load up some Minecraft and just do some building because that's what I like to do in my free time kind of thing. And then I'll load up Minecraft and it's like you dig the first piece of grass and you're like, this ain't it.
Yeah.
It sucked, dude. Like it's been sucking so much.
I have no clue. What is the thing that causes that to happen? What is the mechanism by which you can prevent it from happening in the future? Because every game that I enjoy, I don't enjoy right now. And I keep loading and downloading new games. Like, I'll install Witcher 3, I'll boot it up a little bit, and I'm like, nah, this isn't doing it either. All right, this is Wolfenstein? Nope, not gonna finish that, I guess.
Yep.
Peace.
Back to the drawing board, and yeah. I don't know, dude. And I'm literally doing the exact same thing that you're doing. I'm going, well, I guess instead of doing a long running series right now, let me just do random Olexa looks on random little mini games and checking out, you know, new stuff. And then, you know, I'll play those new games and I'm like, damn, this game was really fun. And then the next day I'm like, yeah, I'm probably never going to play it again though. Like there's a new game, I'm not sure if you've seen anything about it. It's called Beat Blast.
No, nothing about it.
Okay, so Beat Blast, super duper fascinating game, dude. It's essentially it's a top-down roguelite shooter, akin to games such as Enter the Gungeon, etc., etc. And in case you haven't heard of it, but it, all of the your damage from the game, you're essentially making on this like piano board of sorts, and you collect you collect notes and kind of drop them onto this grid, and the grid goes from left to right, kind of hitting squares. You know, think of it like a Excel spreadsheet in a way, and there's like four rows and like eight columns, and you're going it's just going left to right down those rows, and you can fill in certain boxes on the grid, and each of them do a different like damage effect for your character. And then each of them is also making a note that like plays, so you're making music as you're doing your damage, and you can freely adjust where you want things to be. And it was such a fascinating game with some just amazing mechanics, and I played it for 30 minutes and then never launched it again. And I'm like, it's such a good game, and I hate the fact that my brain is like, I don't want to play that, even though like I'm sitting here right now going, the game's great and everybody should check it out.
I'm now actually heartbroken to hear you say that you didn't want to play that game again, because it sounds really charming.
Dude, it's super good. Like, it's genuinely, if somebody were to ask me right now, you know, what's a game in the past couple weeks that you've just really, really enjoyed, I would tell you Beat Blast 100%. And yet here I am, and I have absolutely no desire to play it.
Is it like the body saying, hey, go engage in some of your other hobbies for the moment?
Maybe. Right? Maybe. It could be. I won't deny. It could be. And it's, I feel like that's, you know, it's one of those things that it becomes difficult for us, because at least I'll say it's difficult for me. I don't want to speak for you, since know, you're doing YouTube and Twitch full time. So you're
well, usually.
Yeah, yeah. But your hobby is your job kind of thing. At least one of your hobbies is your job. Whereas, you know, my hobby is my second job. You know? So it's difficult to get away when you don't have the time to do everything you need to do. You know? It's difficult.
But it's difficult to get away when you don't have the time to do all of what you need to do. I might need you to clarify.
Yeah, so like, you know, I wake up, it's 8 hours of work, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then I got about, let's see, I got about 6 more hours in my day after those 8 hours of work. So I got 6 hours to record YouTube content for 2.5 of it, eat dinner, and then I got about 2 hours to myself, right? Mm-hmm. So it's difficult to get away and take the time off because then I'm taking off of YouTube, which then things spiral and then people are wondering where I'm at. And then, you know, you watch the little YouTube numbers go red and then you're like, oh, I'm not doing good enough. And then it just, it all spirals, you know?
Yeah.
You get it.
Right. I get you. I totally yeah, get you.
You get it.
Yeah. I don't know. It's the... But is it so? In some of my discussions with Teak, we talk a lot before we end up recording the ladder streak for the week.
Yeah.
And the idea that he's enlightened me with is the idea of filling buckets. Of you have all of these different needs in your life, and you need to appropriately give resources to each of them, and they will take each of themselves in care, or rather, they in turn will. Care for you.
Yeah.
So the idea of like, I need to play a different game so that I can actually create content, or like these kind of abstract relations of I need to go outside for a walk, otherwise I'm not able to do my job.
Yeah.
Like that's something that I've started to appreciate more recently.
Yeah. No, I completely understand that and agree with it. I think it's one of those things where it's easy to sit and hear that, but then it's significantly harder to make the decision to follow that, you know?
Mm. Definitely, definitely.
Where are you at on your run?
First elite, second floor.
Wow. Really?
What about yourself?
I'm on the second floor boss.
Oh, good.
I'm faster than I thought. Yeah,
I've got a very slow deck because I'm just running with Fear No Evils as well as the ways to exit my stance and a Flurry of Blows. So gotcha. I just play Flurry of Blows, Fear No Evil, Flurry of Blows, exit stance, Flurry of Blows, Fear
No
Evil.
Yeah. I got you. I'm in one of those runs where it's kind of just moving and. I'm not necessarily in fear at all. I think that it could be going better, but I don't really. I'm not concerned. It's a good feeling. It's a good feeling.
Did you pick up the cursed key on the first boss?
Come on. you know me. Yes. You know me. I took cursed key.
That's bad for me. Yeah. I went pyramid for the fun of it.
Really?
If you get your 5 curses, I probably just lose to the point score off of that.
I have 3 curses currently. And then on top of those 3 curses, I am also Pauper Highlander. So if I pull it off, I'm feeling okay.
You already went Pauper?
Yeah. Yeah, I had no reason to not do it. So
that's fair enough.
Yeah, it was a little early. Yeah, it was a little early, but it was kind of like I have the time right now to do it, so I might as well just do it. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, dude. Second floor boss relics are spicy as hell.
Oh, it's gonna be a Snekoi in there, and I'm gonna have to take it with my Runic Pyramid to try and pull this victory out. Is that gonna be it?
It is a Snekoi.
Mm-hmm.
but I will not be taking it, even though I have 5 of my 14 cards are 2 cost or higher.
Why would you not take it?
Because there is a better relic for me to take.
Damn.
So we will see whether or not you still think that is the right choice, but I think I have made the correct choice. I'll just leave it at that.
I'll tell cryptic. You in a couple thousand years when I get
there. I'm going to play it. Dude, soon this is going to become the Olexa playing shapes.io during the Slay the Spire series streak.
I am currently locked in a hand of 3 cost cards that I cannot play in the Sneko fight with a pyramid, so I might die here. I got a Flurry of Blows at 2 cost. I get to play it.
I was going to say, that would be not great, but...
Oh, Sneko hurt too much.
Dude, my deck is so good, though. I'm actually in awe that I suck at the Watcher. That's like one... Mm-hmm. That's my one Slay the Spire downfall, is I'm insanely bad at playing as the Watcher. So I'm on top of the world right now.
I'm extremely glad to hear it.
Thank you. I just bought a fruit juice in a shop. That's how on top of the world I am.
You have to have like a ridiculous excess of money, right?
I had a lot of money. Yeah, I was sitting at like 750 when I went into that shop.
What are the most impactful buys that you've made so far?
I would say, what have I bought, to be honest? Akabeko has been a surprisingly good pickup for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have a chance to get Wallop on that first hand. So getting, essentially an extra 8 block in my first hit is real good. I'll be honest, I haven't bought that much else. So not a lot has been my best buy because I don't buy anything.
So, I bought a couple cards. So how much money are you floating then?
I've got 392 right now.
Nice.
Yeah. And I'm not sure I will actually hit another shop. Nah, I probably will.
Got dinner for two with a stutter as my goals.
That's not great.
6-9.
That's okay.
It's not bad. Could be a little
Yeah, good. Yeah.
I recently in the Ladder Streak series with Sneaky Tick had a second floor where we exited with over 1,000 gold. Apparently that's not normal to do.
That's absurdly good.
I stock up my resources. I don't know. Like I won't spend them unless I'm definitely going to get the game winning resource out of them.
Yeah.
It's a bad habit.
Is that how you are in real life?
What decision in real life would it necessarily impact?
Well, do you enjoy keeping your resources close to heart, or are you the kind of person that you're here for the now and the future is the future? I'll worry about that in the future.
So, I'm not here for the now. I'm here for the past. I will just dwell in the past.
Okay.
I don't exist in the moment or the future. I don't even think about the future. Not enough time to worry about that.
Understood.
Then, with respect to managing the resources, like monetarily, I will gestate a purchasing decision for about a year and a half. Okay. And then over the course of the time that I've decided eventually to buy the thing, they will have released 7 different updates, new models, different versions. The technology will have changed completely and people aren't using what I want anymore. Like, by the time I decide that I want to buy a penny farthing, people are inventing motorcycles, is what I'm saying, right?
So basically when the 3090 NVIDIA card got released today, you were sitting there going, that's
a 970.
That's a 2050 issue.
Exactly, yeah. I'll pick it up in 2050.
I see.
I am currently running a 970, and I might upgrade to that.
You're
running a
970?
Yeah, 970.
GTX. How are you playing The Witcher?
That's a great question, isn't it? It's weird because I know that I know that the specs of my PC, at least for the work that I do, aren't actually that great.
They're
but
not.
But they don't let me down at all.
Dude,
I have never encountered a problem.
Yeah. Hey, what? if you're blessed enough to have that, then hey, keep with it. That's my opinion.
But I also want to upgrade.
Yeah, I get that too. For the longest time, I was rocking. I would say, and so until it was not last year around this time, but the year before. I didn't even have a desktop. I did all my recording from like middle of 2018 before on a like crappy laptop. And that, once you make the change over to a good PC, it's one of those things where you can never go back. Like, it's such a monumental difference.
I worry that I'm about to experience that if I do decide to upgrade. Like, yeah. I'll end up in a position where I end up with a 144Hz monitor or something like that. Right? Yeah, I've got a good refresh rate and everything looks really crisp and clean.
Yeah.
And then I will never be able to use another PC in my entire life other than my own.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely... I'm not going to say it's impossible, as I definitely could see that being the case.
Although then again, like, how much is that going to negatively affect me? I don't use any other PCs.
Yeah, you're chilling.
I have been toying a lot recently with the idea of just replacing my current PC setup and just taking that downstairs, bringing it up to the main TV and making it a media PC, and then just buying myself a new PC for work. Because it has been, 5 years since I updated it all, and the graphics card. But
yeah,
I don't know what is when do you know it's time to upgrade?
For me, because I will tell you, my crappy little laptop had a 960M in it, which, to be fair, is pretty close to your 970.
Yeah.
And it reached the point where, I looked at a game like Minecraft and I was running it at like 20 FPS with the new updates. And how the hell did you do the Build the Brewery series on a 970?
I have no clue.
Okay.
It wasn't a problem at all. It even looked good.
Okay. That's blowing my mind like a lot right now, but
I'm gonna tab out and check Specky. I want to know exactly what I have.
that I don't know how you pulled that off, to be blunt.
I'm gonna say magic.
Yeah, I'm gonna also say magic because that's about right. But yeah,
970. it is a 4 gig GTX 970.
Not sure that really makes a huge difference, but sure.
No? Okay, yeah, it's 970. Sure. I've also got 16 gig of RAM.
That's pretty good.
An i7 at 3.2.
Dude, an i7 is very good. I was on an i5 with my 960M, so.
Yes, I did make sure to get a better CPU, specifically for running things like OBS as well as video editing.
Yeah. No,
Although now OBS supports NVENC, so like I'm doing that on my graphics card anyway.
I see.
And I know that Premiere now supports CUDA as well, so correct. I'm doing that on my graphics card as well.
Yeah. I just recently, I use Vegas instead of Premiere, and it's one of those things where everybody and their mother can sit and tell me that Premiere is better than Vegas, and I will sit there and smile and nod and agree with you that Premiere is better than Vegas, and I will still use Vegas because I'm just so used to it at this point that I can't afford to make the switch. And that's like coming from someone, I use all of the Adobe Suite products. Like I know how to use Adobe products. I just have no interest in switching at this point. But I just recently bought the $120 upgrade to Vegas in order to have my GPU process my videos, so it was like 4 times faster, and the purchase is still hurting me because literally nothing changed in the software pretty much, and I'm like, feel like I just got super gypped, and I know that I got super gypped, and it hurts, but...
That in particular was really annoying, because there were a bunch of things in Sony Vegas that I loved as features, but one of the reasons that I went across was for queuing up in Media Encoder. That was just a feature that I needed at the time. And then it happened afterwards that CUDA came out on Premiere Pro, so that was also really helpful. But I was not looking for Media Encoder at that time, I would still be using Vegas Pro.
Yeah.
And I would similarly be very annoyed that they were charging me so that I could use my graphics card.
Yeah. Yeah, no, it hurts. It hurts, but that, you know, that's life, right? Dude, I'm hurting right now, just so you know.
I hate to say that I'm glad to hear it, but are you perfecting your bosses as well?
I perfected one boss, but I've perfected a good chunk of elites.
Okay. Oh God. No, wait, I got it. Whew. I don't know if I will win this run. I don't know if I'm going to win it this decade. I have a lot of hand lock going on, is the thing. I always have a handful of, like, not always, but I commonly have a handful of 10 cards at the start of my turn.
I see.
It's not doing too well. It's just a very slow deck. This is the kind of deck that if I was going for, like, a heart run, this is what I want. But if I'm going for a run in a Slay the Spire Draft Champions, I don't want this deck. I want Wrath, I want Halt, I want Tantrum, I want all that jazz.
Yeah. I'm currently doing a fun thing called popping two regen potions in this fight to attempt
get that
to...
51 health.
Attempt to get my health back up.
It's a damn fine way to do it.
Yeah, little scary because I desperately need it.
Mm-hmm.
But it's a good thing. We'll pretend. And it's the Darkling fight, so I can kind of milk it as long as I want.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm chilling.
Oh, it's a good one. Can I may actually enter Mantra. Maybe Prey was the best card put in this deck.
I go into Mantra pretty regularly. It's been nice. I enjoy a good Mantra deck in Slay the Spire.
I love a good Mantra deck. One of my favorite kinds of decks for the Watcher is just get a source of divinity in there, oftentimes Blasphemy, and then just blow up the enemies on one turn, which does not work for the heart because you've got to do it a couple turns in a row. But it is one of my favorite builds for them as well. Like, in particular, actually, Snekoi Double Worship is
fun.
It's such a good silent. Watch it.
It's all the same. Dude, I love having insights as well. Insight is just very nice to have.
I would value it a lot more if I didn't already have too many cards in hand, because oftentimes I look at it and I'm just like, I have to burn this out of hand, get a different card instead.
Yeah.
But it is, like, especially in a deck that does have, like, you have a Prey and a Mantra, right?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah, it really helps you offset the card negativity of the other cards unless they're giving you Divinity at the time. Super handy.
Yeah.
The more I play with the Watcher, the more I appreciate her set.
I mean, look, I'm gonna be blunt. I still don't really like the Watcher. I actively try to avoid playing as this character, but I'm having a good time with this run. It might be because I'm kicking ass with the run, but that's beside the point.
It's been very effectively done.
It's been enjoyable.
I may have developed an infinite here, actually.
Really?
It's very complex, but I think I have the pieces. If I sat down for a while, I would be able to figure out exactly how to do it.
Yeah, how to do it regularly.
Exactly. Well, I know which one you went for. You rang that bell, right?
I did indeed.
That confirms your five curses, because you had three before it, four with it, indeed, five on the next floor.
No, I am on the awakened one fight with with my five curses, Pauper, Highlander. I just need to win now. And even still, like, I could still lose this, and it would not surprise me. I will not flawless this fight either.
That is one thing. I have flawless both of the bosses so far. That is the one thing I have on my side at this point. I'm also Pauper.
You probably have.
I don't know. If I remove my second Fear No Evil.
Close enough.
I do it every time. If I remove my second Fear No Evil, I also have Highlander, actually.
Okay.
Maybe I'm still in the races for this one.
Time will tell, I suppose. I'm wishing the best for you.
Much appreciated. I am also, to immediately go against the thing I just recently said, I'm also wishing well for you in that fight.
It's going okay. At the absolute least,
I'm hoping you have a good time in that fight.
It's going, honestly, I would say it's going pretty good. I got 46 health. He's going into his second phase.
Mm-hmm.
I think I'll be okay.
Did you give him much strength at all? Are you running any power?
He's got one strength. So I'm doing all right. I am running my only powers in the deck. I've got a study, which is shuffling those insights in. Mm-hmm. And that do be it. I got a very no power setup. And I'm enjoying it. No power, good power.
It does feel like oftentimes with this, the Watcher, you can end up with way too many powers and no way to really play.
Yeah, I would agree. Oh, spicy.
See, the thing is, this shop is offering me a second Flurry of Blows, which would make the deck work, but then I'm no longer a Highlander.
True. I had that multiple times where I could have gotten like multiple Prey pluses on the run, and I'm like, I could be going into Divinity like every other turn right now, mm-hmm. but I don't really think, I don't think it's the move if I want to get the highest score possible.
You're not wrong. I'm gonna take a potion that'll help me get into Wrath to see if that is enough to just push for the final turn against the boss. May well be.
Best of luck. Oh, this turn sucks. Hell.
Oof. I was about to say, how's it going for you?
I'm at 13 health, so...
That's significantly less than the 46 you had prior.
That is accurate. Could be better. Could definitely be better. Could also be much, much worse.
How's the enemy doing, though?
He's got 152 health. So, could also be much, much better. He is about to take a lot. Yeah, he's taking a lot.
Of your HP or damage?
No, damage. He's got 64 health.
Mm-hmm.
I got a very, very lucky fossilized helix right now, which I received from that calling bell call to action.
Mm-hmm.
Which without it, I would be in a real jam right now. It's gonna be down to the wire. I need to kill him like right now.
I'm legitimately trying to figure out what the scores are gonna be, and if you do get that kill, yeah, I think it might be really, really, really close.
I think I'm dead.
Oh.
Seriously.
No. You have to say this a couple times before you're actually dead. I've seen this one before.
That is fair. I think I am though. Yeah, I definitely am. Wow.
Good God.
It. I have a lizard tail.
There we go. I knew it every time.
I'm so sorry.
This is why I can't trust.
I'm actually so sorry. I killed him.
Well done.
That's so good.
numbers and just keep going off. God, this is just going to be so much of this is just me going back and forth playing the exact same two cards. Actually, that's not going to work because you've also got a visual side on your side. I was about to just like cast this run to Discord, but you've got your shapes.io.
I'm going to play some GeoGuessr. What could go wrong, right? When in doubt, a little Geo.
I really wish that it was like after the Wholesome First Live that people were sticking around to play GeoGuessr and not before it. Because before it, I'm like, it's 5:30 a.m. I can't join.
Yeah. Dude, I want to be able to do it again. It's been several weeks since I was able to do the before Wholesome versus Geo. And it was a ton of fun. Myself, Mr. Penta, Mr. Orbital, Lolash. It was the crew for sure. It was like the unwholesome boys. It was really good. All right, tell me about your run. Where are you at?
Struggling against the Maw. Anyone who has too much HP for me is just real annoying.
Yeah.
So they're just annoying because I have to play Flurry of Blows 50 times.
Yeah. So your primary damage dealer is a Fury of Blows.
Yeah.
Now, do you have a way to get into Wrath?
I do have a potion for getting into Wrath if I need it.
So you're literally in Calm, Empty Mind, Calm, Empty Mind. Or no.
And Empty Body.
Yeah. You knew what I was talking about.
Yeah.
I gotta dig through the brain reservoir and pull out watcher cards that I haven't memorized. But okay. Does sound painful.
I've got a fasting helping me out a little bit. So I do have 4 extra attack and 4 extra dex as well. So it's not bad. It's just so slow. I went from the the Maw fight to the giant head fight. This fight is gonna take me 1,000 years. I'm never gonna be done with this fight. One of my descendants will have to finish this fight for me.
How are you getting the block to keep yourself alive in these fights?
I've got a couple copies of Protect as well as Third Eye, but gotcha. Third Eye Empty Body is also really good because it's the 7 block, but it goes up to 14 after I play the fasting.
Yeah.
Fasting is not a problem for me at all in this run. One less energy every turn, and it's totally fine just because of the amount of starts dancing.
Yeah.
It's the one thing I really appreciate about the run. You know what? I figured it out. I'm just going to cycle Prey until I can do it. Until I can win.
Just going to go into Divinity. Just get that Divinity forever.
It's the only thing I can do. I do. Like, I can play Prey like 10 times in a turn if I just focus on playing it.
That's kind of how I was, because the insights were just wrapping cards around for me. And the issue was it was wrapping, my curses were bad. Like, I had a regret, I had a pain. So it was, most of the damage that I took on the run was from curses. So I'm hoping that it helps, but...
I mean, like, that's the exact same reason that I went with the Runic Pyramid over the Cursed Key, because I knew that I had a relatively thin deck and I was drawing it a lot commonly and didn't want to end up just drawing the same curses. But maybe I would have preferred that in this situation, because I'd prefer to draw a bunch of curses and still kill the enemy than sit here and just watch the enemy just laugh at me for a while.
Yeah, no, I get that.
Let's do it. Pheno Evil, Empty Mind. Yeah, there's some sort of an infinite in here somewhere. I know it's in here.
Yeah,
I
just gotta find it.
If I was doing like a solo play, I would definitely like find this and just consistently execute on it. But it is too many moving pieces for the commentary brain to currently handle.
I was never freaking Sri Lanka, dude. That was always my one thing with Slay the Spire, was I could get a run good, but like, you know, the challenge kind of runs where the achievement hunter, where it's like the have 5 cards in your deck, my brain just goes like, I have no idea how to make an infinite with 5 cards. And I still have not completed the achievement. Like, I just have no idea. I know there's, like, a rampage bash dropkick kind of thing you can do.
You don't even like need to put rampage in there.
Silent discard. I mean, yeah, that's true. There's silent discard decks that I know work, but I'm trigger happy with adding cards, but I also feel like I'm not, so it's tough.
It really does feel like a lot of the infinites, you can't necessarily, like, specifically for that one, you have to build towards the infinite from the first pace and just accept,
for sure,
if I don't
yeah.
hit this five card infinite, I lose. I'm not gonna win this run.
Yeah.
Which is the really annoying thing, because especially if you played all of the rest of the game first and become really competent at the rest of the game, then you instinctively want to create a deck that will live, and in doing so, you fail that achievement.
Yeah. I understand that.
I was lucky that I did that achievement back when I was the thin deck daddy. Back when that's all I did.
Yeah, I feel like every Spire player goes through phases of sorts, right? And you go through the phase where you're very, you like the thin deck. Well, you start where it's, I don't know the card, so you take every card kind of thing.
Yes.
And you have like a 70 card deck and you're like, this is okay. Then after that, you start to realize that, you know, maybe I can skip some cards.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get down to like a 40 card deck. And then you're like, what happens if I just don't take cards? And now you're rocking like 10, 15 card decks. And that's when you're like, oh crap, I'm good at the game. But then there reaches a point where you're like, that's also not how you win this game. And you actually do need cards in order to win the card game.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when you've like really figured out how to play. Is when you know, it's the understanding of knowing that, oh, this is a thin card deck, and oh, this is a thick card deck, not that, oh, one or the other is the move.
Yeah, you go instead from I have taking cards is good to taking cards is bad to taking cards is situational.
Yes.
Exactly. It seems like the more you know about Slay the Spire, the more often the answer to a question is, it depends.
Yeah. Which is, dude, that's the beauty. That's why I love, and we'll talk about the balance of Slay the Spire ad nauseum. And I'll say the M word here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that Monster Train has that same kind of balance in it. And I might be wrong, because I didn't play as much Monster Train as I've played Slay the Spire. But I felt that there were some cards and minions and etc. in Monster Train where it was just like, if I got that minion, I'm enjoying my life with that minion. And there's never a time where I wouldn't put that minion into my deck kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. I experienced that a lot at the Covenants 1 through like 15.
Gotcha.
But as soon as I got to Covenant 25, it was very much like, if I don't play with intent, I'm just gonna lose every time.
Yeah.
So it like I do tend to agree broadly, I will say. But I have fought a little bit back against my own feeling of that recently.
I see. Yeah, I mean, like I said, I didn't play enough Monster Train to get to that point. You know, I was playing, I think the highest Covenant I got was 4 when I played. Which I know is literally nothing.
That's totally fine.
Especially, I mean, hell, Slay the Spire, technically the highest Ascension level I ever got was 12? Because I just stopped grinding them because nobody was watching them on YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
And I still talk about wanting to go back and just, because I know, in my heart of hearts, I know that I can win an Ascension 20 run. Like, I'm confident in my own Spire abilities. I'm bad at the game, but I even a broken clock is right twice a day kind of thing.
Just law of large numbers plays sometimes.
Yeah, I'm confident that I could get there.
Yes.
But I don't know. I love that about Spire and Monster Train though. I love the very aggressive difficulty scaling in a roguelite.
Yes.
And just it keeps it so fresh, right?
So, like, if a roguelike has one level of difficulty... actually, I'll even bring this back to talking about Rogue Legacy, right? One of the reasons that I think you don't dislike it, one of the reasons I know I didn't necessarily... or one of the reasons I think you dislike it, or the system that it proposes, and one of the reasons that I disliked it, is because the game's difficulty is not tied to your skill or to a challenge you're taking on, but instead... decreases over time as you get all of these extra abilities for your character, especially to a point that you just end up with ridiculous HP. It is not fairly balanced out by the extra challenges you take on through the extra bosses. But in Slay the Spire, in Monster Train, why I think Ascension and Covenant is such a really interesting system is because it avoids the roguelike trap. But as you get better at the game, you can still move up. You can still make it harder on yourself so that it's still engaging and challenging as it was in the first 10 hours. But now it's more fun because you understand it all as well.
Well, that was, I don't know, there was another game I played recently called Core Defense. Not sure if you've seen it.
No.
So it's a tower defense game, which I know automatically your eyes roll to the back of your head with boredom, because that's how I felt too.
I don't
like tower defense games.
Okay.
I think that it's a super oversaturated market for them.
100%.
Yeah.
Like a good tower defense game is like a diamond in the rough.
Yeah. That's kind of my opinion too. It's like I enjoy, if it's a solid tower defense game, then I enjoy it every once in a while kind of thing, but it's not the kind of game that I'm not searching on Steam best tower defense game and trying to play that one immediately kind of thing. But Core Defense, it was more focused on a roguelite kind of model, where after each wave, you got the choice of like three things to pick. And then if you flawless the round, you got another choice of three things to pick. So there's incentive to flawless the round kind of thing. But what that game does is it has straight up like 10 ascension levels type things, and it's just little modifiers that it tweaks in terms of like enemy speed and, you know, your tower health, and it just is very, very slight percentage pieces that go down, but it shows you all of them in a slider. So you literally, you know, the far left is, you know, level zero, nothing. And then you scroll all the way to the right to, you know, the ascension 20, and it's literally like the entire page is filled with all the things that changed in that thing. And it's just, it was one of those things where I looked at it and I was like, all of a sudden I want to master all 20 levels of this. Like it's just the seeing how much changes, all of a sudden you've captivated my interest in wanting to play all of them.
I wonder if games would have like a much better experience of their difficulty systems if it was on the front, like
very
all,
transparent
all
about
like
what changes in the difficulty level. Because a lot of the times, you know, like an RPG, it's like you get less health drops, and it's like, okay, tell me in detail the percentage point of how little health drops I get. Like, I want to know every little bit of detail. I want to know the inner mechanisms of the game, how it works. That's what drives me crazy, because, like, you know, I've played a lot of The Binding of Isaac. You've played a lot of The Binding of Isaac. There are still mechanics in Isaac that nobody friggin' knows, like, how they work. And people ask me all the time, they're like, Tyler, tell me, how does Libra calculate how it changes stats? And I'm like, I don't freaking know. I got 2,500 hours in this game. I know that if I have high speed, I'll take Libra. So speed does something. Other than that, I got no freaking clue. And like, it's not documented anywhere. You go to the Isaac Wiki and they're like, you know, shrug emoji. I don't know. It's like, I want to know the inner mechanisms of how everything works. And with a card game like Slay the Spire and Monster Train, you can calculate that stuff. Like, you know exactly how much damage you're going to do. You know exactly, you know, how much the enemy's hitting you for. Whereas other games like an Isaac and Enter the Gungeon, it's not as transparent, everything that's going on.
Sometimes I do appreciate the inverse of it, though, like especially in Enter the Gungeon. Like, I don't want the damage number above the enemy's head, and I don't want the damage number of my own gun. because the feeling I get it, like, I feel like that actually might even interfere with the way that I play that game, because the way that I play that game is not analytical. I'm not sitting down and calculating.
So you like to do the haha, this gun go burr, and I like how look?
No, it's not even that. It's just like, I will, if I ignore the numbers in that game, I will get a sense for how good the guns are individually exclusive outside of the numbers. And sometimes I'll go and I'll look on the wiki page and I'll see the numbers for the gun and I'm like, these numbers look bad, yeah. But I know the gun is good.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
And it's very much like whether or not you need to have that information to actually help you, or if giving that information to you might cloud your choice.
Yeah.
I think in games like Enter the Gungeon, especially for me at the absolute least, it does cloud my choice. But yeah, in obviously this game, obviously in Monster Train, obviously in Into the Breach, I really, really like when I get like as much information from the game as possible so that I can play as tactically as possible.
Yeah. And that's, I mean, look, that's the beauty of the roguelite genre, right? You're put in a situation where you have all these games that fall under the exact same, you know, realm. But you also have, they're so drastically different as well.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
How long until we get an actual name for the genre? Because like, we're not going to call them roguelike and souls-like and things forever, right? Because Doom-like is what all the old FPSs used to get called. Quake-like or yeah. Doom-like? Was it Doom-like? It was Doom-like.
Doom-like is good enough.
But like, they legitimately all got used to get called that. That's what in the magazines, it was like the newest, greatest Doom likes. Like,
yeah.
Where are we going from here?
Dude, it's hard to tell, but I will tell you, I'm already seeing in, you know, emails that I get, I'll get Gungeon like, Isaac like, you know? And it's like, oh, have we advanced to a new era where a top down shooter is a Gungeon like?
Oh,
and I don't know. I don't know if I'm on board yet.
I had that a lot with Nuclear Thrones, like, which this kind of dates the video, but Rip Vlambeer.
Oh yeah.
You saw that this morning.
Took me a second to remember what Vlambeer was, but yeah, I did see this.
I mean, I hope they're doing it to go on to bigger and better projects.
It's not what it sounded like, to be honest, but we can hope, right?
Is there a subtle context I was missing?
It was just, you know, they kind of, it felt like, I don't know. I their post was kind of the sad positive kind of thing,
mm-hmm.
where it was, there's obviously, like, this is bad news, but we're happy about the good news because don't be sad kind of thing. And I feel like if you ever try to do the don't be sad kind of thing, that sometimes it is supposed to be sad. Right?
So if someone's trying to do the don't be sad thing, they might be intending for the sad? Or
well, it's like, more that they don't want you to be sad that they're sad.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
you know, it's kind of like if you're in a bad mood, you don't want to record content in that bad mood because you know that your bad mood is going to be portrayed across the video, and then you're going to be upset that you might be putting the people watching the video into a bad mood because you're in a bad mood.
Okay.
You get what I'm saying?
Okay. Yeah. As long as it's as benign as that, because I was like, oh no, I hope that it's not like, oh god, what's his name? Jan something and Rami, like, I hope there's no tension.
Yeah, no, I don't think that was it at all. I think we might have both taken the context differently, and thus now we're in two different areas, and we don't know how to bring it back to, okay, Raps, hey! How's your run?
I'm running against the spikers. I got another giant head after the previous giant head, so nice. I'm real slow. I'm about to enter the final fight, though.
Nice. That's good.
Get hyped for that.
It's exciting.
Will only take a very long time. Actually, it shouldn't take that long. I did take a flex potion and a strength potion for this fight.
That's good. Do you have a way to get a artifact?
No. Oh. So that is going to be very much my kill turn.
Yeah. Oh, that's good at least.
Very glad to have the incense burner now as well.
Did you take Snecko?
No.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, I think the outside of the boss choices, the relics are effectively seeded.
Yeah. Did you take Curse Bell?
Also no. I went with the Forge Hammer.
Oh. Okay. Because I had gotten my incense burner and my Cursed Bell.
Huh. So did in your Cursed Bell, did you get Oddly Smooth Stone, Incense Burner, Nunchaku?
Indeed I did.
Yeah. Indeed I did.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. That is interesting. So those next three, there is a common, there is a rare, and there is an uncommon in them.
Yeah.
And when you get the bell, it gives you a common, a rare, and an uncommon relic. Which it's weird that you took that and got those three, and then I didn't take that, but over the next three rooms, I still got those three.
So
the next three were determined to be common, uncommon, rare as well because of the bell?
You know, we were just talking about how we enjoy knowing the nitty-gritty insides of Slay the Spire, and yet we have absolutely no idea how they generate the floors whatsoever because they didn't tell us.
What a damn clue.
And now I want to know. I want to know how they do it. I don't know. It's also, I feel like, at least for me personally, coming from a technical background, I'm always interested in picking apart things and just, you know, even like I studied malware analysis in school a little bit, which was taking, you know, a piece of malware and digging into like the literal binary code of the file and determining, you know, how the malware was affecting the computer and things like that. And it's incredibly tedious to do stuff like that. But in the end, when you can sit there and be like, this piece of malware, the devil's devil's lettuce, which would be a very, very strange malware. The devil's cabbage. This piece of malware does exactly this, that, and that. It writes this file to here and that file to there. And I love that kind of thing. So picking apart a game is the same kind of feeling for me, right?
Mm-hmm. Are there many games that like encapsulate or capitalize upon rather that feeling? Like, would a Shenzhen IO be like that to you?
So it's crazy, right? I just installed. I now have my Steam on my screen right now. I literally just installed Shenzhen IO.
I'm glad to hear it.
August 30th, so 2 days ago. because I was like, oh, this could maybe make an interesting Alexa look to have people yell at me that I don't know what I'm doing, kind of thing. And I loaded it up and was immediately completely lost and went out of the brain for this and shut it down. But the idea of Shenzhen IO, absolutely. I mean, it's basically just, yes, it's a game of machine code, you know, similar to like a human resource machine by the World of Goo dev team.
Yes.
Very, very similar, where that is, it's quite literally just coding, but in a cute sense, right?
What's the other game?
The other one?
The guy who did Shenzhen IO also did it.
The Zachtronic games. There's now I'm gonna literally just do this
infinitely
live.
Infinitely many different ones there, of those.
Yeah, of the exact same kind of, yeah. Molex Synthes, which no idea. Exapunks, Opus Magnum, that one I've at least heard of.
Yes, Opus Magnum is really interesting as well.
Yeah. No, but I have the intention of checking out those kinds of games because you're right. I enjoy that kind of style. And now I'm scrolling down my Steam library trying to think if there's other games that fit that same. I don't know, dude. I love puzzle games. I just love puzzles. I love puzzles so much. I know we talked about this recently too.
Do you have a favorite puzzle game?
I mean, okay, let's pick that apart a little bit further. Sure. Are we talking
what counts
like,
as a puzzle game?
Yeah, are we talking like, you know, are you saying would you consider Portal 2 to be the greatest puzzle game of all time? Are you saying, like, in terms of a puzzle game, are you taking a Sudoku or are you taking a crossword? Because it's very different, right?
They are very different. Like, the level of mechanical abstraction is very different in each of them. But yeah, the thing is, both of them, to me, fall under puzzle games because both of them are... The entire thing is not about execution. It's about figuring out how to execute it in order to get something done. Right?
Yeah.
I wonder if that's too broad a general definition for puzzle game.
No, I don't think so. I do think that you can maybe break that definition, though. Because, like, for instance, Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes.
Yeah.
Is that a puzzle game?
Yeah. It's a collaborative puzzle game, but it's a puzzle game nonetheless. Okay.
Does that fit your definition, though?
Oh, my God.
Because I'm not sure it does.
My modded file has, you feel that you have dealt a total of 9,999,693 damage to the heart. One run away from
your
million
one
damage.
Run away.
Oh, hell yeah. I do think Keitain fits, is the thing. I think it is legitimately a puzzle game. Is it an action game? Is it an adventure? Is it a roguelite?
Honestly, now I'm gonna take a look. Keep Talking, Nobody Explodes. Store page. I want to see what the tags are. Co-op puzzle. All right, fair enough.
See,
fair enough.
The thing is, like, all of these appeals to genre that I'm currently making are awful appeals, right? Because the borders of these genres are fuzzy. And if we look back with different definitions of genres in the future, this game will not be the same genre as it used to be. So I will say anything that is possibly a puzzle game counts as a puzzle game for the sake of the question that I'm asking. Hey, Olexa, puzzle games, what are the favorite
puzzle game of all time? Haven't even finished it, but I'm gonna hit you with The Witness.
Oh, love it.
Great game.
The Witness is in the weird, annoying position of I didn't have the PC to run it at the time that it came out, so I watched all the reviews for it, and every single one of them said, now, this is the spoiler-free part of the review done. Stop watching.
Yeah.
Seriously, just stop watching right now or you'll ruin it for yourself. And I was like, I know, no better than that. I'll continue watching. And I ruined it for myself.
Yeah, so I'm going to be completely honest with you. So I had gotten it. It was part of like a PlayStation Plus free game week thing. Some like 4 years ago or some garbage. So I had picked it up during that, and I had, like, started it, and then my dad came into the room. He was like, what are you playing? And I was like, oh, it's this puzzle game. So he sat down, and he was watching a little bit. Pretty soon, the two of us, you know, we had, like, Word docs open, tracking notes, and so it was just, like, for a while, it was just the game that him and I would sit down and we would play. And we never finished it, but I think we got at least a little bit close. And we still talk about, like, pulling out the PS4 and trying to finish Witness. But I also don't know the ending. Well, that's not also, but I don't know the ending. I never spoiled myself with it. So I still sit here and I'm like, I think The Witness is my favorite puzzle game. And I have no idea how it ends.
But pull the PS4 back out. Maybe that's the game that you've got to get to.
Yeah, maybe that's where my gamer depression ends. Anyway, Raps. What's your score, brother? You above 1,000.
Ooh, I'm going to pull my page back up because I deleted it already.
Oh, no.
Run history. What do you got for us here? Oh, God. Is the thing about to crash? It's stopped responding. No, it's come up. We're fine. Yes, it's above 1,000.
Is it above 1,100?
Yes.
Is it below 1,300?
Yes.
Is it above 1,200?
Mm-hmm.
Is it above 1205?
Yes.
Oh, no. I am 1206.
It is 1206.
What?
No. Sorry.
Oh. That would have been cool.
It would have been the first tie ever. Because you hadn't asked about whether it was 1206, I had to confirm. No, I had 1263.
So you had me sizably.
I didn't end up with the Highlander as the thing. I accidentally kept a second Protect in the deck because one was upgraded and the other one wasn't, so I thought they were two different cards.
That hurts, actually. So you, I mean, you bodied me then. For sure.
I mean, I would have needed another opportunity to actually remove the other Protect, so.
Yeah.
This failure to get Highlander is entirely on me.
Hey, a win is a win in the end.
Mm-hmm. It feels nice to be in the Winners Club. I'll go talk to chat about that, the recent Winners Club.
They have been the winners, huh?
They have, really. Like, a couple in a row. What we need to do is just always give chat a dummy deck so that every episode we can claim that chat was the winner. Because, invariably, someone will have been able to get a higher score having analyzed the run, possibly.
Yeah. I can imagine so. Anyway, I guess we'll have to give chat a deck in the next episode. For now, my name is Olexa. His name is Rhapsody. I hope you enjoyed Slay the Spire Draft Champions. We'll be back next week for more Slay the Spire Draft Championing.
Mm-hmm.
That's the first time I've ever done an outro like that. And honestly, I feel dirty or something.
It does feel like you split halfway between your outro and mine.
Yeah. It was, yeah.
My name's been Olexa, his name's been Rhapsody, and welcome. It's like, yeah. I like it.
Yeah, it hit differently.
Yeah, also, 4 p.m. CDT, is it? CDT? 4 p.m. CDT Wednesday, every week we do the Wholesomeverse live. It is a good time. Come and catch and see that on twitch.tv/OlexaStream and twitch.tv/RhapsodyPlays.
For sure. Thanks so much for watching, guys. We'll see you in the next one. You have a good rest of your day. Bye-bye.
Adios.